Welcome back. We're going to go into a bit more detail now on users, groups, roles, and policies. These are really important elements of the IAM service. So we have our account, and within our account, we have users, groups, roles, and policies. These are things we can create within our account. Now, a group is basically a container into which you can place your users. So for example, we can add this user to our group, and you can add many users to a group. We can then apply something called a policy to our group. The policy defines the permissions for the identities or resources they're associated with. In this case, the user gains the permissions that are applied to the group through the policy. So the policy has a set of permissions defined, it's applied to the group, and then the user is in the group and therefore gets those permissions. This is what's known as an identity-based policy because it's applied to an identity. A user account is an identity. You can apply these to users, groups, and to roles. So you can apply it directly to a user, to a group, and then put many users in the group, or to a role. Roles are used for delegation and they get assumed. And you'll see what that means shortly. Let's look at users in a bit more detail. So in our account, we have a root user. Remember, this is the account that was created when we first signed up for AWS, and it uses the email address that you signed up for your account with. The root user has full permissions, and therefore it's a best practice to avoid using the root user, and you should enable multi-factor authentication as well, and we'll see how to do that later on in the section. You then have individual users. So those are user accounts like these three that we have here. You can create up to 5,000 individual user accounts in AWS, and these users will have no permissions by default. So when you create a user account, unless you apply permissions, that user will be able to log in through the management console, but they won't be able to do anything. Now, there's a couple of different names associated with a user. You've got the friendly name, so this is whatever the name of the account is. In this case, I've used the first names of these individuals. And then we have the Amazon resource name. And that's what we see in blue and red. The red portion is the account ID. And then the rest of it just indicates the particular identity within that account. So an ARN, an Amazon resource name, is unique. Not just within accounts, but across accounts as well, because it has that unique identifier in it. So even if you have Andrea in another AWS account, the account number will be different, so the ARN will be different. With user accounts, you've got a few ways of logging in or authenticating to AWS. So that's the management console, the CLI, and the API. With the management console, you're using a username and password. And for the other two methods, you're using something called access keys. And we'll look at those shortly. So we then have groups. With groups, you can create these different containers, like we've got an admin group, we have a development group, and an operations group. So you can mirror whatever account structure or department structure you have within your particular organization. And you can then add your users into those groups. So the groups are the collection of users, and users can be a member of up to 10 groups at any one time. We then apply our permissions policies to groups. This is the main reason why you have groups. So you organize your users by the way that you want to apply permissions to them. In this case, we want to apply different permissions to people who are admins versus developers versus operations personnel. So therefore, we group them into different groups, and then we apply policies to those groups to give them the permissions they need to perform their job role. The user will gain the permissions that are applied to the group through the policy that we apply to that group. So you attach a policy to the group, and then the user gets whatever permissions are applied in that policy. Now, there's a little bit more to it because you can have multiple policies applied to a group, and there's a bit of an evaluation logic in terms of working out what the user should be able to do. And we'll look at that later in the course. We then have IAM roles. A role is an identity that has specific permissions assigned to it, and it's assumed by users, applications, and services. That is, those particular entities are able to assume the role and act as if they are the role. So for example, you might have users, you might have a mobile device, or you might have an application running on a browser, and each of these are able to assume the role. In the case of users, you would run the API action STS assume role. And something similar would be done for a mobile application or a federated application. And when you do that, you're then able to act as if you are the role. So we have permissions applied to the role through a policy. And then once assumed, the identity becomes the role and is able to access AWS resources as if they are that role, as if they have the permissions applied to that role. The access is short term. So it uses something called the security token service. And with a role, you receive short-term credentials. So they only last a specific period of time and then they get automatically renewed. Now, you can also use this across AWS accounts. So we'll see some examples of how to do this later on in the course. So you can have users in another account who are able to assume the role and then access resources as if they were that role. Lastly, we have policies. So remember that these are the way that you apply permissions. You define permissions in a policy document, and they're written in JavaScript object notation, JSON. In this case, we have two different types of policy. The one at the top is an identity-based policy, gets applied to identities, and the one at the bottom is a resource-based policy. It gets applied directly to resources. And you can see what the code looks like in these particular policies. All permissions are implicitly denied by default. So that means that you don't get any rights by default. Everything is denied. And we then have to write statements in JSON to allow access to specific actions. So the example at the top is an identity-based policy, as I mentioned before. You apply that to users, groups, and roles. And the resource-based policy can be applied to resources, and examples are Amazon S3 buckets and DynamoDB tables. In this example, this is a bucket policy, so it gets applied to an S3 bucket. That's everything I wanted to cover in this lesson. I hope it was useful, and I'll see you in the next lesson.